Professor Steven Downs é especialista em tecnologia de aprendizado online e novas mídias, mestre em filosofia pela Universidade de Calgary. Através de uma carreira de 25 anos no campo, Downs desenvolveu e implantou uma série de tecnologias progressivamente mais inovadoras, começando com domínios multi-usuários nos anos 90, comunidades online abertas nos anos 2000 e ambientes de aprendizado pessoal em 2010. Downs também é reconhecido como uma voz de liderança no movimento de educação aberta, tendo desenvolvido trabalhos iniciais em objetos de aprendizagem para uma defesa líder mundial de recursos educacionais abertos e aprendizado livre.
Talk about how analytics works. I'm going to be talking analytics, and then I'll be closing with the concept that's in the title, the duty of care. So let's begin with a quick look at what learning analytics are. So learning analytics is, in essence, as it says here on the side, the science of examining data to draw conclusions when used in decision making to present paths or courses of action. Now, there are various definitions of learning analytics, but most of them are like this. They're about using computers that gather data of some sort, process that data to help us do our job, to help us teach, to help us learn, to help us manage our society. Now, there are different types of uses of analytics, and I'm drawing from a distinction here that I found in this paper here in EDUCAUSE, distinguishing between academic analytics and learning analytics. Academic analytics are analytics that are used for the management of a university or a college or an educational institution, to manage enrollment, for example, to manage the allocation of resources, the business day-to-day affairs. And that's contrasted with learning analytics, which is more focused on the pedagogy, the management of the learning process itself. Now, in learning analytics, there are different types of learning analytics, different ways computer programs can be used to help us manage and support learning on a day-to-day basis. And here I'm drawing from Boyer and Bonin, who identify four major application areas: descriptive analytics, diagnostic analytics, predictive analytics, and prescriptive analytics. And to these four categories, I am adding a fifth category, which I will call deontic analytics. And I looked it up, it's invented here, so yay. Let me begin with descriptive analytics. And this is analytics basically which are used to describe. They look at data, they identify different categories of data or some trends in the data. The sort of analytics that will produce bar charts or pie diagrams or visualizations, these all fall under the heading of descriptive analytics. And the purpose here is just to help the user understand the situation as it is now. If I used descriptive analytics here, I might say that there's a certain number of people from Teresina, a certain number of people from Sao Paulo, etc. Diagnostic analytics looks more deeply at the data to try to identify patterns and trends that are not evident in the surface data. For example, if I'm using analytics and I'm looking at text that people have written, and I'm comparing the text, I might use diagnostic analytics to do plagiarism detection. I can do that by looking at the patterns and the ways a student writes to identify differences in the way that student writes to identify plagiarism. And there's one interesting case that came up recently where diagnostic analytics were used to look at a play by William Shakespeare written just at the end of his life, so he didn't finish it, called Henry VIII. And they used these analytics to determine which words were written by Shakespeare himself and which words were written by a guy called John Fletcher, who I had never heard of. Predictive analytics are, as the name sort of implies, about predicting what will happen. For example, predicting student learning success and providing proactive feedback. A lot of the learning analytics that learning management systems contain mainstream, although we're beginning to see prescriptive analytics be developed. For example, artificial intelligence-based coaching. Prescriptive analytics are analytics that try to help you determine what to do. They might be recommender systems, they might be personal assistant systems, anything that helps you decide or helps you determine what action to take. There are companies that offer leadership coaching, but it's very expensive because coaches are expensive. But the promise of prescriptive analytics is that coaching will be available for all of us. So we can all be as good a human being as our managers and our executives. That was a joke. Sometimes jokes don't translate well. But for those of you who are listening to this recording from Canada, I'm sure you're rolling, to be honest. Now there's the category that I would like to add called deontic analytics. And deontic analytics are intended to answer the question, what ought to happen? What is the course of action that should be taking place? That is the right thing to take place. A good example of deontic analytics is in self-driving vehicles. And should it swerve to avoid a cat? Yes. Or should it hit the people instead? No. These are drawn from Philippa Foote's famous trolley problem. You want to look that up when you're doing your reading. It's just deciding which of two ethically ambiguous courses of action the automatic vehicle should take. But we can imagine deontic analytics being applied in many other areas as well. More questions of this sort, of what is the right thing? What is the right thing to teach a person? What is the right resource to give to a person, morally and ethically speaking, will be and can be determined by analytics, which of course raises some questions in our minds. And so we turn to ethics in learning analytics and looking at the things that should happen and the things that shouldn't happen. And I'm drawing here on a characterization I found in a document. It's just a panel workshop that divides these issues into three categories. Because analytics is particularly complex. Sometimes there are ethical questions about what we should do when analytics works. Other times, the ethical questions arise when analytics does not work properly. And sometimes, the sort of thing that we're thinking about is probably fundamentally wrong to begin with. Those are the three categories that Marianne and others came up with. So let's look at when analytics works. And here we have cases where we worry about what happens if it's successful. Content identification, face recognition technology, creative functions, for example, deepfakes. These are all cases where we have seen evidence that analytics works really well. It is successful in its application. And we're asking whether it should be. For example, analytics, correctly applied, can, in fact, violate privacy. It can be used to reveal information about people that was not intended to be revealed. There's even a company called InBloom that actually had to close because it was using analytics on school children and eventually violating their privacy. There's a whole range privacy-related issues with respect to analytics. I won't list them all. I'm sure you've probably heard of many of them. We also have cases where analytics questions are used for assessment. Now, I'm not talking about questionable assessment, for example, grading papers or things like that, but assessment where the results are probably pretty accurate. For example, if you live in a certain district in a city, analytics will tell you that you are probably more likely or less likely to be a victim of a crime. Now, analytics gets this right. Analytics is able to correctly make these predictions. But then these predictions are used in order to set your insurance rates, so that if you live in a poor area of the city, you have to pay higher insurance. And so there's an ethical question here. Is that how insurance should work? Is that how analytics should work? Analytics successfully applied can also be used to manipulate data. For example, there's a company that manipulated, or not just, sorry, let me start that again. Analytics correctly applied can also be used to manipulate people. It can cause them to believe false things. For example, with deep fakes, it's possible to create a video of something that never happened. If I had more time, I'd show you one. But you can find them online. There's lots of them. There's one out there of Richard Nixon talking about how the nation was sad because the moon landing failed and how the astronauts would live on forever on the moon. Of course, that never happened, but there's a very convincing video of that. Another way analytics can manipulate us is to manipulate our emotions, which is very dangerous, especially in a democracy, where emotion often can result in political consequences. There was a case where experiments were undertaken with Facebook news feeds to see if they could create one emotion or another emotion by changing the news feed. And they found that they could. So there were several issues here. They were experimenting on people without their knowledge, and they were making people feel things without considering whether there might be a danger or a bad result. When analytics fails, it can also produce ethical consequences. For example, spam detection, essay grading, hate speech detection, content recommendation. We've all seen cases where analytics works very badly. I don't know if you watch Netflix frequently here in Brazil. Do you watch Netflix? Yeah? Awesome. Are the recommendations good? No. My recommendations are terrible on Netflix. That's an example of the failure of analytics in Netflix. I keep getting cowboy films, because I watched a cowboy film once, and now it always wants me to watch cowboy films. I'm not a cowboy film. So, what are the sorts of ways analytics can go wrong? Well, there's bias. There's bias that might be caused by an incomplete or skewed data set, by bad labeling, by feature manipulation. We'll talk about some of those things in the future. But the result of that is that the analytics may work well for one demographic group and very poorly for another, or it may prefer one type of candidate for a job and not prefer another candidate for a job based on their gender or their race or their religion or whatever. The worst cases of analytics, analytic ethics comes up when the use of analytics is fundamentally dubious in the first place. The question of whether we should be doing analytics in this area at all. Now, in the categorization here, it talks about when analytics are used for social predictions, social functions. For example, predicting whether somebody will commit a crime at second time, predicting the effect of policing, predicting terrorist attacks, predicting a person's job performance and then hiring or not hiring. These are cases where we're not even sure we should be using analytics in these areas. One example I might draw on is something called the identity graph. Here is a case where analytics are used to create a shadow profile of every person. Whether or not they use social networks, their activities are from website to website are tracked, and then each person has an individual profile where they've been, what they've done, what their religion is, what their background is, what they like, what they don't like. And this profile is called an identity graph. You might ask, should we be doing that at all? It's not an appropriate use of technology at all. It's perfectly legal and is being used to this day. Similarly, there's racial profiling. Facial recognition technology, for example, that looks at a person's face and based on their face determines what race they are. There's a system, for example, that was used to identify Uyghurs in Western China. Uyghurs are a minority Muslim group in Western China, and then targeting these people for special treatment by the police based on their race. Now, there are many cases of racial profiling that happen in society. Imagine if that was done automatically by a machine. Clearly, there are cases here where the use of analytics is fundamentally dubious. Now, I want to look at a fourth class of issues related to analytics that was not among the three that were identified: social and cultural issues. These are cases where analytics, if they are used, have an impact on the social and cultural infrastructure of society. They change the way our society works, and they change it in a way that might be ethically questionable. For example, questions of consent. A lot of analytics is used on us, on people, whether or not we want them to. And it's not just a case of the gathering of data, although Google had a project called Project Nightingale, where they were gathering health information about people without ever telling the people that their health information was being gathered by Google. But even the application of analytics might be imposed without our consent. Can you imagine, for example, a case where if you want to see a doctor, you have to see a robot doctor and not a human being, and that's the only way you can get health services? Can you imagine if you want to take a class and you have to take it from a robot teacher and not a human being? This is a significant social and cultural impact. But then again, it's already kind of happening. We don't question whether an engineer uses a computer and analytics to build a bridge. That's no problem. So what makes healthcare and teaching different? It's a hard question. There's also been a lot of talk about building the surveillance culture. There's one case where a man tried to avoid the cameras by covering his face, and he was arrested and charged with a crime, disorderly behavior, because he was trying to hide from the surveillance. So he must be doing something wrong, right? And this is resulting in a society where surveillance is becoming normal, where there are cameras everywhere. And even very aware of that camera. Sorry, video people. And Maya raises the question, is the sharing culture one and the same with the surveillance culture? Are we trying to take control of how we're surveilled by sharing? And I think, well, yeah, maybe. And maybe that's a good thing. Maybe it's not a good thing. How do we decide? Audrey Waters talks a lot about the oppressive economy created by analytics and technology. All of these products use human labor. We'll come back to that. But the point she makes is that they use the labor of people, the places they go on the web, the things they do, the clothes they wear, and then they use it against us in order to create basically a surveillance capitalist society. You know, we even have a case where scholarship, both the content and the structure of scholarship, is reduced to data. Try writing a paper and submitting a paper without some pseudo-analytical survey results. Now, try getting one published without that. It's not easy. Analytics is pervading our culture and making us serve the analytical machine. Presumably, I would say, there are ethical questions. And I would take it even a step further, and this is something that maybe we want to investigate a bit. There are people who talk about analytics removing the humanity from our educational systems, our social systems, our healthcare systems, our justice systems. I think about what that means, and I think what it means is that we're losing our sense of right and wrong. And certainly, when we look at political affairs around the world, that seems to be the case. And it's like we are deferring our own judgments about right and wrong to the machine, or at least to the television, to the internet, and to the algorithm. And that's an ethical issue as well. Now, there are different approaches in ethics to answer all of these questions. I want to briefly survey them to draw a point here. So there are different ethical theories, and what ethical theories are generally is a way of coming up with reasons or an argument or maybe evidence that will persuade us, first of all, what we should do, what is ethically correct, and secondly, to actually convince us to behave ethically. Immanuel Kant said that ethics and freedom are part of the same thing, that ethics is defined by freedom, and that ethics is essentially the result of a person applying reason to their freedom to act. Well, there are different types of ethics, different types of ethical systems. One ancient ethical system is based on moral virtues. The idea is to strive to be the best person you can be. The virtues might include honesty, courage, compassion, generosity, etc. And these virtues that a person might have are the dispositions, are the tendencies that we would have in order to act correctly. But what is the list of virtues? How do we determine what goes on this and what does not go on this? You look at the writings of Friedrich Nietzsche, for example, as an effective counter-argument. Nietzsche looks at the gods from ancient society, Zeus, Hera, Ares, and the rest, and observes they do not behave in an ethical manner at all. Yet they're gods. They must have virtues. otherwise they wouldn't be gods. So if Superman were here, what would be ethically right for Superman? Well, we think it would be honesty, courage, compassion, or it might be truth, justice, and the American way. And now we have some very questionable ethical virtues. Another major type of ethical theory is consequentialism. Do no harm, right? Here is a case where ethics is determined by the results or the consequences of our action. Consequentialism looks at the result and says, is this a good result or is this a bad result? But what is a good result? What is a bad result? Well, there's pleasure, that's a good result, right? The philosophy that believes that is called hedonism. But there might be other good results. There might be, as John Stuart Mill said, the higher pleasures, the enjoyment of a good book, the working out of a difficult argument. But it's hard to define. And what about the cases where the right result comes out by accident? What if you intended to kill a person but accidentally saved their life? Were you ethically okay then? Another set of arguments is based on the idea of rights. And this comes from Immanuel Kant. Yeah, same guy. And Kant says each person is inherently valuable, inherently worthwhile, or as he would say, an end in and of themselves. They should not be used for other purposes. So as a result, the reasonable person, realizing this, looks at what kind of ethical theory should we have, and comes to the realization that people ought to have individual rights in order to maximize the possibility that each person can live their best life. And it's not just that, it's based on the inherent dignity of the person. And when we talk about ethics harming human dignity, now we're appealing to kind of a rights-based theory of ethics. Today we see this in constitution theory, which derives from the arguments of John Locke, Thomas Hobbes, the French revolutionist, the American revolutionist, the Bill of Rights, and today the most prominent advocate is John Rawls, who wrote a book called A Theory of Justice, in which he defines justice as fairness. And so when your little kid says, that's not fair, they are appealing to John Rawls and Immanuel Kant and the theory of ethics based on fairness. They might not know that, but that's what they're doing. And this is the idea that all people are equal and all people should be treated equally. Or if we're treating them unequally, then we're treating them in some manner that is just. That has, you know, there's the element here, it's from Kant, but also from the law codes of Solon in ancient Athens. The idea that we have one law that applies to everyone. There aren't special laws for the rich and for the famous. Now that's an ethic that is noticeably absent in many societies. Finally, there's an argument based on the common good. It says basically, we are a member of a society, and that our society, our community, is a good in itself. And we are in fundamentally relations with with other people. And these relationships are what defines ethics. Now, there's a range of possibilities here. On the one hand, we have Marxism and communism as an ethical theory. We have communitarian-based ethical philosophies such as Ubuntu, the idea of community and sharing and common wealth and common resources. We have cooperativism, collectivism, social cohesion. You know, the sort of ethic that you get from living in a small town in the country in hostile conditions where everybody must depend on everyone else. As Xi Jinping says, of his bringing up, there was 7 years of rural life that gave him something mysterious and sacred. And I think anyone who's lived in a small town, and I've lived in a small town, understands that feeling. Now, what we've done in order to address the question of ethics and analytics and ethics elsewhere, for the most part, has been to draft ethical codes. Now, I'm going to go through a bunch of ethical codes here. You won't even be able to read them all. Don't worry, you have my slides. But I want to show you especially the variety and the range of ethical codes that have been developed for analytics over the years. Let's begin with research ethics, which is where a lot of this began, and arguably research ethics begins with the Nuremberg codes and the idea that you should not do experiments, especially crazy sadistic experiments, on people who are not willing to be experimented on and cannot get away. More fundamentally, it's the idea that ethics ought to constrain research. And so we have the common code, the common rule, federal regulations for research in the United States, in this code. We also have healthcare ethics, too many different sets of principles to write down. I haven't even listed them, but there is a reference here. The core of healthcare ethics typically involves autonomy, benefit, doing good rather than wrong, non-maleficence, not being evil, and justice. Well, it's a pretty vague way to decide on medical ethics. That's what comes out at the end when we look at a bunch of ethical codes for healthcare. What about data analytics? Here's a code from Insights Association. Prioritize data subject privacy, sure. Be honest, transparent. There's virtue ethics, right? Respect the rights of all beings, so that's a different ethical theory. Always distinguish between research and non-research activities. Why? Because you might do marketing as well while you're doing research. And do not do any action without a person's consent. Maybe rights based again, right? Data science and ethics and government, here's another code. Start with clear user need and public benefit. We have that code at the National Research Council. You sort of go like, why does there have to be a public benefit for my research to be ethical? That's a puzzle. Create robust data science models. We'll come back to that. Be alert to public perceptions. Is the public perception part of ethics? Keep data secure. Here's another one, Council for Big Data Ethics and Society. Respect for persons. So this is the human dignity side of it, I would say. Balancing of risk to individuals with benefit to society. So here we have a case of consequentialism and communitarianism in the same principle. It says, speak slow, please. Okay. I'll try. I'm working against the clock. Independent review of research results as a matter of ethics. Funding dependent on ethical standards. So there's an element here of penalty or punishment for violation. That's an interesting thing that wasn't in the other ethical theories that we looked at. Here's one, data research ethics from the Open University. This one is interesting. Aligning the use of student data to core university values. So basically, the Open University has defined its own values as the definition of ethically right, which is puzzling to me. Purpose and boundaries engage students in the use of their data. So that's more than just consent, isn't it? Here we have 10 sample rules for data research. I like this one. Acknowledge that data are people and can do harm. I know, I don't understand it either. 6, debate the tough ethical choices. When a politician says, I am going to make some tough decisions, what they mean is, I am going to make a decision that harms you, not me. Engage with the broader consequences of data and analytics practices. So here we have consequentialism. Ethics in Learning Analytics. This is an ICDE publication. We have transparency, data ownership and control, institutional responsibility and obligation to act, inclusion, consent. So we have some rights theory, we have some communitarian theory, we still have some consequentialism. Here's from Britain's GIST. Responsibility, privacy, validity. Validity as an ethical principle is very interesting. Minimizing adverse impacts is a consequentialist factor. These are draft Barcelona principles. They call it like the Barcelona blueprint. It just came out the other day. There's a group of open educators led by Moodle, in this case. Do no harm. The first of these principles to say do no harm. Acknowledge and address the difficulties of de-identification of privacy. So, all of this leaves me asking a lot of questions. Which ethical theory are these principles following? All of them and none of them. When these ethical theories are in collision, as they very often are, how are they making these decisions? How do we, as individuals, pick from among all of these different codes of practice principles? What makes one of these right and another one wrong? What are the justifications for the individual elements in the provision? What are we trying to do with these ethical codes? I read something in the if the headline on the front page of the newspaper were reporting abuse of customer data, how would you react? If you wouldn't want your personal data used in a certain way, chances are your customers wouldn't either. Now, that's a fancy way of stating the golden rule. But the golden rule fails. The golden rule fails if the person is Mark Zuckerberg and doesn't care. The golden rule fails if the person is Donald Trump, I'll say it, and doesn't care. Right? And we can think of in our lives people who treat other people badly but would not care. The person who comes along and says, it's just business. I would expect you to do the same for something very unethical. So, what is the purpose of ethics? Is it just to keep bad headlines out of the newspaper? Well, let's talk for a few moments, not long, about how analytics works. The way analytics works is we have a big, huge pile of data, and we feed it into an analytics engine, and it produces a result. And we keep doing that until it produces the result we want. Like this. This is an analytical engine. So it's a neural network. Most analytics use neural networks today. Not all, but most. It has artificial neurons, which are very simple and have values of 1 or 0. And it has connections between those neurons, which are also very simple. And the whole thing together is called a model. You can all understand that, right? It's simple. So, here's what we do. We take this simple engine, this simple model, and we train it with big data input. That's why people are always talking about you have to get your sample data right. You have to get your training data right. We're feeding data into this machine. And out the other end comes output. And what we're trying to do is get the output to a desired state based on the input. So we feed the input in, the signal is sent through the little network, and it produces an output. Now, the first time you do that, it probably doesn't produce the right output. So you give it feedback, you adjust all connection links, and you do it again, and you do it again, and you do it again, and you do it 1,000, 10,000, 100,000 times until the network reliably produces the right output. That's analytic, training of an analytics engine. And then to apply it, we use that same engine, the model, give it new data, and it produces new output. Now, there are many different ways of doing this. There are many different ways of defining how those connections work, how those neurons work. There are many different ways of collecting, organizing, and labeling the data, both the data that feeds in and the output. So, analytics impacts ethics in these areas, in data. What are our data sources? Did we actively intervene to produce data? Is the data linked to other data? Did the data change? Is the data reliable? All of that has ethical impact. Model. That's the neurons and the connections. How do we define that model? When we define the output that we're looking for, how do we define that? Who said what the correct output is? What are the labels that we use? Models are trained, sure, but the design of the model itself is the result of a lot of computer programming. Who decides the ethics of the computer program? Testing. Nobody talks about testing of these models, but testing is important. Is the model being tested under real world conditions, or is it being tested under laboratory conditions? The translation app was probably tested, but it was not tested under real world conditions. So when it was tested, it worked perfectly. But with a room full of people, it works differently. Application. Should we use analytics this way? Is this output that we're getting an ethically appropriate output? What about the impact of fees and costs for the use of the model? Do only some people get to use analytics? Can the output of the model be explained? And this is an important question. I'm going to back up here for just a second. These are not words. They're not principles. They're not rules. They're not regulations. They are just numbers. They don't stand for anything. So, and there's thousands of them. They are what we might call sub-symbolic. So, if a model produces an output, how do we explain how it got that output? It did not follow a rule. But when we get an explanation, we want a rule, don't we? Don't we? All this leads to the observation that we are the machine in analytics. There was a paper a number of years ago by a guy called Michael Wesch called "The Machine is Using Us." Actually, it was a video. But the idea here is we produce the data, we produce the programming, we produce the labels. We are the ones producing analytics. The ethics of our analytics depends on our ethics. So, who is it speaking for us in analytics? Josh Feast says, we need to ensure diversity in the training samples and ensure that humans labeling the samples come from diverse backgrounds. Because presumably diversity is ethically good. But diversity wasn't in any of those moral or ethical theories that I talked about. Maybe fairness? Recognizing different identities, acknowledging diversity of community. Maybe that's fairness. Maybe that's communitarianism. It's hard to say. And we are more than just data input to these systems, aren't we? We're more than just people who shovel data into the machine. Analytics treats data subjects as passive, but, you know, as a set of variables, but we have something to say to the machine. How do we say it? You know, in a way, our society is analytics as well. Our society looks like that, just like learning analytics. And the experiences we have that we report on social media or on our blogs or in messages are sent from person to person to person and produce an output. And the output might be good, it might be bad. It might be a new housing project, it might be a revolution. need to take care in our analytics. And I want to introduce you to a theory that is not the same as the other ethical theories. The other ethical theories, remember, were all based on the idea that we use reason to determine ethical behavior. But what if we don't use reason? Now, there's a legal concept called the duty of care, a legal obligation imposed on an individual not to be careless when they're fulfilling a function. We're not really talking about that. And there's a business concept of the duty of care. And I'll quote here, a fiduciary responsibility held by company directors which requires them to live up to a certain standard of care. Now, I rarely see that actually applied. Now, the duty of care I'm talking about comes from an ethics of care, first formulated by a writer called Carol Gilligan, who proposed the care perspective as an alternative to the moral reasoning employed by more masculine liberal justice traditions, which we've just been looking at. She characterized it as a difference of theme, though, rather than of gender, and I think that's probably accurate, because here I am doing the theme. Carol Gilligan, and I agree, says that moral accounts don't take into account the lived lives of people. And that when we look at these moral codes, we're always going to find a case where they don't apply, or they apply incorrectly, or they perpetuate an injustice. The classic case is, would you steal bread to feed your child? And I hope the answer is yes, but I don't think that there's a moral code that permits that. You know, she's arguing against a theory of rights that really treats us as independent from other people, not connected to other people, and having moral obligations, duties, rights, responsibilities, simply on the basis of abstract principle, rather than on the basis of our day-to-day lives, our own personal experience, and our own personal feelings. I think there's a lot to be said for that. Mel Noddings draws on this theory, talks about relationships as being basically, ontologically basic to humanity. These are fundamental. And so the caring, the person who's doing the caring isn't just doing something abstract. They're doing something as a perceived response to a need of another person. So the interaction happens, and the person receiving the care and the person providing the care are both involved in this action. What is care? Well, in the duty of care, there's a lot of different accounts of care in the duty of care literature. And again, I gave you homework. Part of the homework is looking this up. But it's most often defined as a practice, a virtue, a disposition. A lot of people fall back on virtue ethics, trying to define the duty of care. But you know, when they do that, they're falling back into this moral reasoning paradigm. And it's often an overlapping set of concepts. It's often vague. It's not rules. It's not principles. It's the human reaction in a given situation, in a given community. The virtuous dispositions, again, I think that falls back into that other theory, but the tentative responsibility, competence, responsiveness. But look, In this account, nobody has a checkbox and says, were you attentive, right? Were you responsible? Were you competent? But rather, their recognition by the person that these are all things that come into play. They're more like a toolbox than they are a set of requirements, right? And the duty of care and ethics related to care aren't just concerned about gender relations, and they recognize that, you know, the identity of a person is defined by many things, by gender, by economic circumstances, by culture, religion, language, by the place where they live in the city, by whether they had pets when they grew up, by a whole range of things. And there's no set of rules that is going to be able to categorize and classify people so that you get some kind of prescriptive account of what you should do. Which is why, in this model, ethics is your personal response based on, well, we'll come to that, a lifetime of caring to that person in that circumstance, with that background, with that need. And it's an interactive, iterative process. You've no rules to guide you. Our intuition, maybe. Our sentiment, maybe. And even questions of who we have duties to are kind of vague, right? Do we have a duty to the company that we work for? Well, sometimes. It depends. Do we have a duty to our children and our families? Now nodding can say yes. Do we have duty to future people who don't exist yet? An environmentalist would say yes. Do we acquire duties on an involuntary basis? Does a student, by virtue of being a student, have a duty to a teacher whether they like it or not? That doesn't seem right. Does a patient in a hospital have a duty to abide by what the physician tells them? I read recently, it's not on the slide, I read recently, somebody said, we have found a universal set of moral principles. And principle number 6 was respect for authority. Do we have a duty to respect authority? Answer, yeah, sometimes yes. You know, but always? And there are limits of duty. Do you have a duty in a futile case? It's not on the slide, but I have a reference. If the patient is about to die, do you have a duty to try to cure them, even though you can't do anything? If a student cannot be educated, do you have a duty to educate? It's an interesting question. How do you decide? There are no rules. Oh, thank you. I thought they were going to kick me off. You know, I think we can go beyond what we can do beyond the concept of beauty. And I kind of borrowed from Stephen Forth, who's writing about competencies. And I just substituted the word duty for the word competency. With duties, we take this one hard problem and created out of it 10 equally hard problems. We try to list the rules. We take the hard problem of ethics and create 10 hard problems defining the rules. Duty-based models, we get stress because they're rigid top-down. If we have a list of things we must do, that's not normally how we go. today, you are probably not going to murder a person. Please say you are not going to go out and murder a person. But why not? Because it's against the law? Is that what stops you? Because you might be caught? Is that what stops you? Or is it because you believe it's fundamentally wrong to murder a person? You don't need a rule. You don't need a system of ethics. You feel it, right? I think that the theory that Carol Gilligan and others are talking about is a theory that can be classified under the heading of moral sentiment. It responds to exclusively rational systems of thought, which have as their ground a disregard for anything personal. And instead, roots the theory in inherently personal, sometimes gender-based, sometimes race-based, sometimes culturally-based knowledge, acknowledged constructions. This is actually a theory that has a philosophical background. David Hume, writing in the 1700s, wrote of a theory of morals based on a moral sense. And the idea is that our moral distinctions depend on our experiencing sentiments or feelings. Now, this isn't a theory of natural morality or innate morality. We're not saying that we're born with some principle of morality in our head, but it does say that we make our ethical decisions based on this sense or these feelings rather than rules or regulations. Which leads to the question of how do we learn ethics? How do we acquire these senses or feelings? Bear with me, we're almost there. Well, there's the ethical practices that we undergo on a day-to-day basis, right? But a lot of times this is done wrong. Typical management framework. Recognize an issue, get the facts, evaluate the alternatives, make a decision and test. In software programming, that would be called the waterfall method. We know it doesn't work. And it doesn't work for ethics either. Culture of data governance. Now this is getting a bit closer, right? What we're after here isn't a set of principles of data governance, but rather a common feeling in a company or an institution or in a society, which we describe using the word culture. This is just the way we do it. You just protect privacy, because that's what we do in our culture. But it still leaves open the question of how do you build that culture? But I can flip back, remember, we are the machine. We are the ones who define our culture. The things we do, the things we write, the things we say are what define that culture. Ethical practices. If we behave ethically, that becomes part of our ethical culture. If we behave unethically, however defined, that becomes our ethical culture. Now, the way our leaders behave, the way the people on the television behave, the way our role models behave, defines, or at least influences the ethics of the culture. And there's no rules or principles. ceremony here. Why did we do that? We were feeding data into the machine that defines an ethical culture for this society, right? We were saying very clearly, this is what we think is right, and here's a process. We are making these ethical decisions every day. Not based on rules or principles, but based on our evaluations of what we think is good. It's an ethics of sympathy, ideally. Now, we live in a society now where we point to some rule and we say, you broke that rule, you are evil. We have this righteous indignation. But that's the opposite of a good way to produce ethics. The good way to produce ethics is through some kind of sympathy and understanding and reaching out and connecting with the other person. It's recognizing ambiguity. In practice, it's impossible to define most things. It's impossible to define a good employee. It's impossible to define a good essay. But we feed data into the machine in the form of how we recognize this. It's a way of openness. You think about openness, what openness is. We've talked about open educational resources and open pedagogy. But again, it's not a set of rules or principles. It is not, David Wiley, a licensing mechanism. It is a way of being, right? It's a way of being open. It's a way of living. You just live your life openly. And I think, for me, this comes up. This comes from growing up in a small town where the way of life in a small town is to live openly. And I think that's the way we used to live way back when all of these ethical principles were being derived. But we became urban, we built walls, we separated ourselves from each other, and we substituted being open with rules, principles, and ways to get around these rules and principles. Loopholes, separation, and the loss of a sense of character. Critical pedagogy is part of this. Critical pedagogy is to create in a person the ability to look at the world for himself or herself, to make their own decisions. But it's more, it's to contemplate the education as a practice of freedom. And again, there isn't a rule here, right? You don't walk up in front of your students and say, okay, rule number one, you will be free. That's an absurd statement. But it's an intent of an education, I would say, to produce freedom. But how do you do that? Well, there's a variety of ways to do that. We talk about the work of Powell Clare. I always want to say free air, and I know it's not right. And I asked somebody the other day, how do you pronounce that correctly? Because I'm in Brazil. Freire. Space is practice. And, but also, respecting freedom is to teach them in a manner that respects and cares for the souls of the students. I wouldn't say souls, now, but for the well-being of the students. And it's an ethics of kindness. And I want to say, just in my own feeling on the matter, that ethics isn't about what you can get away with. Ethics isn't about, it isn't a set of principles about what you ought to do, what you must do. Certainly, I don't think teachers look at ethics that way. It's about what you do, what you can do. It's an opportunity to do do some good in the world rather than a requirement that you must. I was just about to finish. He didn't even know. So, what did Gilligan, the other ethicist from the duty of care, feminist morality, teach us? Teach me, anyways? We're not going to base the ethics of analytics, or for that matter, the ethics of education, or the ethics of learning, on rules or principles. It's not going to be up on the wall. It's going to be here. Right? Also, ethics is a matter of a community as an entire system. We, as a community, are the analytics machine. So our ethics in learning analytics is our ethics as a community. There's no getting around that. And we have to keep in mind how we're all connected. When I make an ethical decision, I'm making it not just for myself, but for everyone around me. If I made the ethical decision to go on beyond 5 minutes, it would affect all of you. Okay, sometimes the joke's longer. Yeah, 86 slides in and I'm still trying to tell a joke. But there's even more. Even more. Because everything I've said about learning analytics applies to you as an individual person and how you learn. The ethics of learning analytics is the ethics of learning. Right? Because it's the same system. It works the same way. You feed data in. It's your experiences. All the things you do, all the things you read, all the things you watch, all the people you talk to, it goes through a neural net and it produces output. What you say, what you do, and then the community feeds back in. And your human knowledge becomes your ethical knowledge. So this is a theory not just about the ethics of learning analytics. This is a theory about the ethics of learning and what we can do, the opportunity that we have today to define for ourselves, not just right in this piece of technology, not just right in social networks and social learning, but to define right for ourselves, for our families, and for our communities. I think it's a great opportunity. It is a challenge. It is complex. But I hope you'll seize that opportunity and make it the best life. Thank you very much.
Agradecemos então a apresentação do professor Steven Downs. Steven, thank you.